Hello, hello, everyone. Welcome back. I am one of your co-hosts, Rico Borrego.
I am your other co-host, Tony Borrego.
And this is the podcast known as Relatively Sound, the podcast that salutes your solution. Today, Tony and I are back. We are going to be doing an album appreciation episode. I think the last time we did one was for Harry Nilsson's album, Nilsson Schmilsson.
That was a while
And
ago.
yeah, I think that was that even this year? I think it was last year, was it not?
No, that had to have been last year.
Yeah. Oh no, yeah, you're right. I don't know why I'm thinking this year is like way later than it already is. Yeah, it was for sure last year. But I think it was like maybe this time last year. I think that's what I was trying to say. Like it's been about a year since we've done it.
Wow.
I
Wow.
think I might be wrong. I don't know. We're actually, I think the episode that is being posted this week, which was the one, no, yeah, the one we last recorded is like our 70th episode.
Oh, okay. Wow. We
So
got
one
some
we're
footsteps.
this one is 71, yeah. So we've definitely, yeah, we have a lot of episodes. But we've only done, I think, album appreciation twice. We did it for REM's Automatic for the People, and then we did it for Harry Nilsson's Nilsson Schmilsson. Today we are going to be talking about the Raconteurs' second studio album titled Consolers of the Lonely. Let's do a little quick history with the band for people who may not be familiar. The Raconteurs, I consider them a super group, a rock band super group of sorts. You have Jack White on vocals and guitar. Obviously, Jack White, if you like rock music, you should know his name. White Stripes, solo projects, Dead Weather. Then you have Brennan Benson also on guitar and vocals. Brennan Benson, not, I would say, as well known as Jack White, but he is a phenomenal singer-songwriter. In fact, I'm sure in the future we'll probably end up doing an album appreciation on one of his solo albums. Then you have Jack Lawerence on bass, and Patrick Keeler on drums, and both of them were in a Cincinnati band titled The Greenhorns. So, you know, all the musicians in this band have they came from other bands or other solo projects to form the Raconteurs. They formed in 2005, and they Jack White and Brennan Benson were friends for a while. In fact, there is a DVD they released a couple years ago where they did like a duet show at like a pretty small, like almost coffee shop venue. And they kind of covered each other's songs. Like Brennan Benson covered a couple White Stripes songs. Jack White covered a couple of Brennan Benson songs like Good to Me and what's that one song off One Mississippi? Cross-eyed Girl? Cross-eyed? Is that what it's called?
Cross-eyed, yeah.
Cross-eyed, yeah. And so yeah, they've been friends for a while. So it took them until 2005 to decide, oh, let's like, you know, let's form a band of our own. So the four of them got together and they formed the Raconteurs. And they released their first full album titled Broken Boy Soldiers in 2005. 2006, sorry. They started writing in 2005. And Steady As She Goes was the lead single. And if you've heard of the Raconteurs, that's probably one of the songs you know from them. And great song, great debut album.
Good video.
Yeah, that one actually has two music videos.
No, there's two.
Yeah, there's like one where it's just like them performing the song like at some weird like rundown house or something. And then there's the one I'm sure you're thinking of, which is them doing like the go-kart racing.
Is there shots of them in the barn, though? Or not the barn, but the rundown thing in the racing one?
I don't
Am I
think
combining
so.
them both?
I think you are, yeah.
Right.
Because like in the racing video, the go-kart videos, each of them are they have their own go-kart that they're racing in.
Right,
And I
right.
can't remember if in the video they're performing the song, like if there's other shots of them with the instruments. I don't remember that. But yeah, great song, great video, great album. And they toured off of it and was pretty successful. And you know, then in between, you know, they would go and Brennan Benson would do solo albums. Jack White did the White Stripes up until when they broke up. And then 2008, they got back together, but they didn't announce it. Like, it was at the time, it was not known that they were working on a second album. And they just like released it with no promo at all. And it was really only confirmed like a week before that there was an album coming out. And I think that it was only known a week before because it was leaked, I think, on iTunes or somewhere. You know, back then in 2008, music leaking was more like, I don't know, like was more magical. Nowadays, like leaks are just kind of like you expect the album to for someone to get their hands on it, right? Like weeks before it's released. But
Right.
yeah, they did no promo for it. It was just like, here's our new album. And you know, they did a music video for their first single, Salute Your Solution. And yeah, so 2008, Consolers of the Lonely comes out, their second studio album. And then they went on a hiatus after that for a while because, again, all the band members have their own thing. Patrick Keeler, the drummer, ended up becoming the drummer for the Afghan Whigs, who is a band I have not heard their music, but I've known their name for a while. And Jack Lawrence, which they call him Little Jack in the band because he is one of two Jacks in the band. I know he does a lot of like touring with other musicians, and he used to play bass for Sitting Color. When he would do shows with like a full band, he played bass. So
Very cool.
that's kind of a cool fact if you know Sitting Color. Yeah, and I remember when I got into the Raconteurs, it was in 2008 when this album came out. I don't think I even knew Steady As She Goes. I just remember going on iTunes because back then, you know, we had iPods, and I was like, I probably had a gift card, and I was like, well, let's go buy some music. And I think it was like number one on the iTunes chart or whatever, for probably for the rock chart. And I like read that like, oh, Jack White is in this band, and I hadn't known Brendan Benson before. So I think I checked out a couple songs, and I probably heard the ones with like Jack White on them. I like this, so I ended up buying the whole album just I think on a whim, and loved it. And then I like looked up who was in the band. I went and bought Broken Boy Soldiers later. Then I got really into Brendan Benson. So it kind of led me to different doors, and I fell in love with this album, and I'm happy to say this is a top 10 album for me easily. I think this is just it's like one of the most solid rock albums in my opinion. I think it's super underrated. I understand some people will probably listen to this album and go, this is not mind-blowing, but a lot of the songs in my top 10 of all time are not mind-blowing albums. Like, I know there's more innovative albums out there when it comes to rock, but I don't have a lot of those in my top 10. To me, it's just albums that I gel with. And this is one of those albums. Like, I love every song. I think the flow is great. I think production is fantastic. Songwriting is top notch. Performances are as good as they could be. Like, it's just an album I can never get tired of, and I could just listen to it. I could probably listen to this album once every day and not get tired of it, which I know it's not always a reason to put it in like in your top 10 albums of all time, but like for me, that's a pretty big factor.
Yeah,
So,
I mean, I think this album is objectively fantastic. I see what you're saying about maybe it's not the most mind-blowing, but it does what it sets out to do, and it does it with great quality, like songwriting, fantastic, no complaints. Production is gorgeous all over the record. It's 55 minutes long, but it doesn't ever really feel tired or stale. It's got a pretty sick album cover too.
I meant to pull this out when we like when I first said the name of the album. So, also doing this for the YouTube thumbnail.
With your ring light reflecting on it.
With my yeah, there we go.
There we go.
That's a little better. That'll be the
With the
thumbnail.
nose just above it, love it.
But sorry, continue. I didn't mean to interrupt you.
No, I'm just basically echoing what you said. I think this is just a really good record.
Do you remember when you first heard it? Like, did I like show you this album like when I bought it on iTunes and put it on my iPod Classic at the time?
So I think the earliest memory I really have of the Raconteurs would probably be Steady As She Goes. you know, the YouTube video, the cars, you know, for some reason too, the bassist, I already know you, little Jack, there you go. His glasses always stuck out with me in the video. It's just, it's a kind of an iconic look, just saying. So yeah. And then I think just kind of throughout our childhood, you know, hearing what you've been listening to, I definitely did pick up on a lot of the songs. I know our grandma really liked the version of Old Enough on this record. The bluegrass version, which I'm sure we'll get into that in a minute. But yeah, I mean, let's dive in it.
Was there a time where this album clicked for you more? Like, is this an album? Because I feel like for me, I loved it on first listen. And like, yeah, like maybe there was a point where when I got older, I was like, is this album really good or is it just nostalgia? And I was like, no, it's really good. But I feel like for you, it probably like over the years has grown more and more on you.
Yeah, I think that is probably true. I think it's one of those, like, I didn't sit down and listen to this album in its entirety when I first heard it. It was more so just catching on to songs and kind of picking favorites. And some of my favorites, you know, still are my favorites now, while some of them, you know, I've kind of grown out of a little more. But I think, yeah, as time goes on, I've kind of just realized, like, okay, wow, this album is actually kind of a masterpiece. I think all of the songs really hold up. And so I don't know if I would say it clicked or anything. It just kind of always seemed there. You know, in preparation for this episode, I've been listening to it a lot. And, yeah, I have not been getting tired of it. You know, every moment hits hard. So for you... Maybe let's start with this. What are some of the standout tracks for you? Because I actually kind of feel like we may have different favorites.
I mean, it's hard. I mean, there's been points when I've listened to this album in the past where probably every song has ended up being a favorite of mine. I mean, maybe like the only exception is Pull This Blanket Off. I mean, that's just because it's like a minute 50. It's like barely 2 minutes, not even quite 2 minutes. And it's kind of more of like, it's not like an interlude track, but...
But it's a fine line between an interlude and filler.
Yeah. It's got a really cool, like, this, like, kind of, like, I don't know how to describe it. Like, not ragtime, but I don't know how to, it's like something you'd hear on MASH or something. I don't know. But other than that song, like, and I still really like that song, but it's not one I, like, go out of my way to listen to. But, like, every other song on here has been a favorite of mine, but, like, right now, if I had to like say my top favorites, for sure would be the almost title track, because the first song on the album opener is called Consoler of the Lonely, not Consolers. And they did the same thing with the first album. Broken Boy Soldiers is the album name, but the title track on the album is called Broken Boy Soldier, no S. So they like to make the title track not plural on the album. And then for their third album, after a long hiatus, they called it Help Us Stranger. But then the song on the album was called Help Me Stranger. So they like to just kind of change the name of the title track a little bit, which is kind of cool. It's funny.
Yeah, I like that. And make it feel like, you know, like they're the consolers. They're the soldiers.
Yeah.
You know, they're the ones in need of help. You know, it's kind of cool.
But yeah, I mean, I would say... the title track, opening song, that's one of my favorites. You Don't Understand Me, which is kind of one of the, I would say, ballads on the album, piano. I would actually say Attention. I think Attention's the most underrated song on the album. And then I think I do have to say Carolina Drama, because it is, even though it's kind of a longer song, it's like, it's got fantastic storytelling from Jack White, and it's got a really great climax at the very end of the song.
Jack's performance sells that song 100%.
What are your favorites?
Well, interesting. The favorites you picked are the ones I remember you liking a lot. So, I mean, that means it holds up then. My favorites, probably Many Shades of Black, like definitely more of an old timey, you know,
fantastic song.
And we have discussed this before. Brendan Benson's best vocal performance ever.
Yeah.
Changed my mind.
They're pretty good. There's a couple on One in Mississippi that are cool, but they're more raw, where Many Shades of Black, they're super clean and impressive. Where on One in Mississippi, they're like, they're cool because he goes really up there and really out there, but it does in like a raw way, right? Like in a...
Right. There's a lot of character on One Mississippi, but I think as far as like impressive and impactful, Many Shades of Black does it for me, which I guess Adele covered too, so...
Yeah, Adele covered it. I don't know like what the occasion was or like why. I know she did. Yeah, she did it like for a live concert that I think was either filmed or recorded. So I'm really curious of, I would love to know like how she ended up, like, I don't know if she just heard that song and she just loved it and covered it. Because this album, when this album came out, I think is around the same time her first album came out, which was not the album that made her as big as like, it was the album before. What was that big song? Rolling in the Deep. That was the album before that.
Okay.
Cause that was in 2000, her first album and Consolers both came out in 2008. Yeah. So,
and didn't you say Lindsay got, actually knew Many Shades of Black because of the Adele version, right?
Yeah. When I was looking on her iTunes one day, I noticed that she had it, the Adele cover of on her Mac. And yeah, I can't remember if she knew at the time it was a cover, but.
Right.
So then I showed her this album and yeah, she was like, yeah, I love this album. She loves a lot of the same ones I love. So that's one of your favorites. What are the others?
Yeah, so that's one of my favorites and it's been one of my favorites for a while. The other longtime favorite would be The Switch and the Spur. I just love how grandiose it gets, you know. There's kind of there's storytelling in it. It's a little more kind of vague, kind of imagery type thing going on.
Very Western feel to the music and actually the storytelling, I would say.
Right, right. With the whole tagline being "You shall never return," makes it feel kind of dramatic there. But yeah, that one's cool. It's got the trumpets.
Yeah,
who doesn't love trumpets?
That song and well, actually the two songs you've mentioned as your favorites both have trumpets.
Right. See, we need more songs with trumpets. Come on.
Yeah, I'm trying to look it up. Because they had a, I thought there. Oh, so the horns on both those two songs you mentioned, they were played by the Memphis Horns.
Memphis Horns. Okay.
Yeah, some group, that I guess Jack White. Jack White knows all the cool people in the industry, so
he's like, I know a guy.
Yeah, so horns on both Many Shades of Black and Switch and the Spur. So that's funny that two of your favorites have that connection.
And then I'm going to pull out a new favorite of mine.
Ooh.
All right. This is one I never disliked it or anything, but maybe it's because it's on the latter half of the album. I just kind of overlooked it. Rich Kid Blues.
Yes, that one has always also been a favorite of mine, and I almost said it when you asked me. But I didn't, but I should have. That one I think I liked a little bit more when I first heard it. I still really like it now. The only thing that dragged it down for me is that I learned it's a cover song.
Yeah, who does it? I remember you told me that, but I've yet to actually go back and listen.
A musician named Terry Reed.
Terry Reed, that sounds familiar, but
yeah, I just am not familiar with that person. So right. That's definitely on me. Terry Reed, I'm trying to see. Oh, I guess Chris Cornell's covered one of his songs. I'm curious which one.
Oh, is this like another Harry Nilsson right now?
Yeah, I'm trying to see if he was like in a band or anything. No, I think he was just a solo artist. Yeah, guitar, vocals. Yeah, we'll have to look him up. Yeah, because Rich Kid Blues is a great song. And
what does it for me with it is really just a performance of the band. It is so musically exciting, like, you know, the increase in tempo as they go into like the instrumental bit, and then Jack White comes in with this, you know, this voice crackle.
Yeah,
and it's just, oh my gosh, it's Jack White at its best.
One of my favorite moments on the album is actually, for some reason, so you get the intro, right, with like it's like a kind of an organ, and then it's the guitar, right, and the vocals, and then the drums kick in, and then they're like, but then there's a moment where the instrumentation drops out except for the vocals and the drums, where he sings like the "What I'm Wondering Why, Girl, Did I Ask Your Name? Are the people standing by? Are they in my game?" And when he says "game," one of the other guitarists comes back into the mix. That, I don't know why, but that's one of my favorite moments. I just love the drop out on the guitars and bass and the drum. Patrick Keeler, I think, is a super underrated drummer. Like, I saw them live, thankfully, a couple of years ago when they did their third album and toured again. And I thought I'd never get to see them live because, you know, they went on a hiatus after this album and tour. And I, you know, didn't get to see him live, but I did. And he's solid. I mean, he's like a Matt Cameron, in my opinion, where he's just super solid. He plays great live. He plays great in the studio. He's kind of got like a jazz element to some of his drumming, I feel like.
I will say that's something I really appreciate on this record and the first record. Like, there's a lot of actually interesting drum parts. And even today, I was listening to Hold Up. And just that little, you know, intro bit, like, I was like listening to the drums and I'm like, oh, this is actually kind of a, you know, something that doesn't seem supernatural, like something I wouldn't think of right off the bat. Like, this is like a creative part. And I think it's little things like that. Like, there's a lot of great just like written sections, but also a lot of good like dropouts throughout the album.
Yeah,
some
I mean,
tempo changes, feel changes.
Yeah, it happens. One of the reasons why the title track, Consoler of the Lonely, is one of my favorites is because, you know, you have that like just kind of monster riff. It's a simple riff, but it feels huge. And one of my favorite things about the Raconteurs and why a lot of people like the Beatles is because you have that Lennon McCartney thing going on with Jack White and Brendan Benson, right? Like some of the songs, it's a clear, they both wrote the songs, right? Like Consoler is like, there's a part where Brendan Benson's singing the verses and Jack White singing the chorus, right? They share verses on Salute Your Solution, on Old Enough. And in Consolers of the Lonely, there's, like you're talking about, there's the tempo change, right? Where the instruments kind of drop out and it's just like the bass for a second and the guitar. And then the drums come in and it's in that double time feel. And then there's a section where near the out, right before the outro, there's just a break. And then there's just a section for the guitar and then for the drums. And then there's even a bass part where they just drop everything out except the bass. So, and that's something they did on their first record too. But I feel like on this album, those moments just sound even bigger than the first album.
Right. The production like really enhances these moments, and Hold Up is like another one like that for me, where like you get like breaks where it's kind of like, I don't know if it's like a guitar with some wah going on. You get some like organ leads. You get like a really cool riff that kind of just changes feel near the end. Another song that does it, which I would have put on the top of the album, but Five on the Five, another fast, energetic song with a really scraggly Jack performance, but I do really admire it. And Rico, I know you're waiting to say this part.
Well, Five on the Five, other than Pull This Blanket Off of Me, is my least favorite song on the album, just because like the whole song, it's good. And surprisingly enough, they actually performed it live on the Broken Boy Soldiers tour. So it was written, I think, way before this album. I don't know if it was the one that just did, if they might have written the song either during touring, or maybe I had a feeling like Jack White probably had this, because it sounds like something that would even be on a White Stripes album. Like, I think if it was a little bit less chaotic, it could definitely be a White Stripes song, something that could have ended up on like Icky Thump. And those type of songs, like, I like the White Stripes, don't get me wrong, but I much prefer the Raconteurs, even though they only have three albums worth. And I even think I prefer some Jack White solo stuff over White Stripes. The only like Jack White band I really don't love is Dead Weather, which, funny enough, Dead Weather has Jack White and Jack Lawrence on bass. And Dean from Queens of the Stone Age, who ends up touring with them on their third album, that when I had the tour that I saw them on. But all that aside, Five on the Five, there's an outro. There's a section near the end where Jack White plays this riff that's in a totally different like rhythm than the rest of the song. And then the drums and bass kick in, and it's just this little like 20-second instrumental section. And it just sounds like Green Day to me, which, okay, there's nothing wrong with Green Day. And I have a soft spot for one of their albums. And surprisingly enough, it's not Dookie or American Idiot. But, and it's not, it's...
Is it 21st not, Century Breakdown?
Maybe. Maybe that's an album you'll get in the future. I don't know. it's not a slight on either band. I just think, like, I don't know. Green Day has their time and place, but it feels a little too simple for the Raconteurs. I don't know. I just don't love that moment in that song. It sounds just like, I don't know, very Green Day.
It's like the one time that the Dropout or Total Field Change does not feel quite that impactful.
Yeah.
And maybe it feels just, like such a, like a non sequitur at the end. It doesn't really push the song somewhere.
Yeah. And it happens on a song that I didn't like immediately love to begin with. So that kind of hurts it. But the song, it's a fun song. It is fun. I prefer, if we're talking about like fun moments on the album, I prefer Hold Up a lot. Like you were saying, something I wanted to talk about on this album is I love the different almost genres you get on this album. You have songs that I think are just like Raconteur songs, if that makes sense. Like Consolers, I don't think that really sounds like anything else. It just sounds like Raconteurs to me. I would even say like Salute Your Solution as well. And You Don't Understand Me Too. But then you have a little bluegrass country with Old Enough and Top Yourself. Old Enough kind of more just country. But then I would say Top Yourself is a little bit of bluegrass, bluesy. You know, there's a lot
it's kind of like blues
slide,
rock.
Slide guitar and stuff. And then you have like the 70s kind of rock sound. And I think Hold Up is like that 70s rock. Like that just sounds like, if you would have told me that was a cover from the 70s, I would have believed you. Like with the wah and the organs that you were talking about.
Right, right. It does have all the makings for that.
Yeah. And then you have kind of the Western sound with Switching the Spur. And also Caroline Drama is kind of a mix between Top Yourself and Switching the Spur. Like it's more dramatic, like Switching the Spur, but it's more definitely the acoustic sound of Top Yourself. And then you have the throwback to like the 50-60 sound with Many Shades of Black that you had referenced earlier.
Pull This Blanket Off.
Yeah, that one also has that kind of old timey sound. And then you have like, you know, the penultimate track, These Stones Will Shout, which I think is also very underrated. I think of that song as, to me, I always thought that, I always compared that song to the Foo Fighters song, But Honestly, which that Foo Fighters song did come out before this, so. And I'm not saying like they ripped it off, but like it's an acoustic song, starts off acoustic, very pretty. In fact, the Raconteurs one is way more intricate in the picking, where the Foo Fighters one is just strumming, right? But with The Stones Will Shout, you got some like really cool picking patterns. And then the song builds at the end out of nowhere almost. Like the bridge, it just gets rock. And then they go to a last chorus where it's like totally rock with like electric guitars and drums and bass. Which is basically the Foo Fighters song, But Honestly. So I think
now
that,
that
is
you
more
mentioned that,
modern.
I do hear how that climax is a bit Foo Fighter style. It has all the ingredients for it.
It is, interesting. But give me that any day over the Green Day comparison.
Right. And to go along with this genre stuff, I do think too, like the production reflects it, like on Many Shades of Black, like I think the bass is panned a little bit. Like it genuinely feels like a, you know, like a more like 60s experience. Which I think is cool. And it's not done to the extent that it's kind of unlistenable or it feels, you know, all over the place as a record. It's surprisingly cohesive. But it is a lot of cool different sounds and styles kind of grouped together. And I think that gives the album a lot of character. Especially like with the album cover, you know, in a song like Switch in the Spur and Old Enough, like I don't know, it paints quite the scene. And I think Old Enough is probably does the best at fusing everything together. It starts off, you know, the most probably, you know, country. It's got, what does it have, like a, it's got some string instrument in it. Does it have a fiddle?
And Old Enough?
Yeah. I'm not good with those type of instruments.
I think that might only be, is that only on the bluegrass version? Because I don't know, on the additional musicians on the Wikipedia page,
It's like a, it's something.
there's someone named Dirk Powell who's is credited for strings,
So that's got to be included.
but that's it. That's the only other thing. Now, on like the bluegrass version, I think there's for sure you have musician Ricky Skaggs playing mandolin, and then you have country artist Ashley Monroe playing vocals. So I don't know, but I get what you're saying. Like it does have like a that kind of fiddle sound,
Right. Well,
Mar a
there,
little
yeah,
Americana. Reminds me of
there
Jason
is some sort
Isbell.
of string thing going on. And
Yeah.
but you have those type of leads paired with like an organ lead, like a real soft one, or
Yeah.
you know, and it's subtle. But by the time you get to the bridge where you get kind of this instrumental riff thing going on, it
Da
gets
na da
spacey.
na na. Yeah.
Yeah.
And
They
the
bring
organ
out.
fills out more of the space.
Right, and it sounds like borderline galactic. Like you go from what you thought was kind of like a stripped back acoustic song, get together, and then you go all the way to like some 70s space jam, and it works flawlessly, and it blows my mind every time. And so it is kind of one of my favorites for that reason. I think it is kind of really well put together.
Maybe my favorite thing about Old Enough, though, is that on the CD version, and I think the streaming version, for sure the CD version, it ends with like some studio kind of chatter. And then you hear, it must be Jack White, start playing this guitar riff for like a second or two, and then it cuts off quick. And that guitar riff is actually the opening guitar riff to an unreleased song from this sessions for this album called Open Your Eyes. Which somehow back in the day when like going to LimeWire and downloading free music illegally, like I somehow downloaded this batch of Brennan Benson demo songs. And funny enough, a lot of them were demos, and a lot of them would actually end up on future albums of his. And a couple of them were like covers and stuff. And one of them was called Open Your Eyes. And for the longest time, I just thought it was a Brendan Benson song, because he sings the majority of the song with Jack White doing harmonies, but the solo was definitely Jack White. But back then, I wasn't musically smart enough to know that. But then, like one day, it connected to me. I was like, wait, that opening riff of "Open Your Eyes" is that riff he plays at the end of "Old Enough." Wait, those are Jack White's harmonies. Wait, that's Jack White's guitar solo. And then funny enough, Brendan Benson re-recorded that song for one of his solo albums called What Kind of World, and he retitled it Here in the Deadlights, and he changed some of the lyrics and some of the instrumentation. Not as good as the Raconteurs version, if I have to say. And they ended up releasing the Raconteurs song. They released it on the Third Man Records vault thing that Jack White does. On a B side, on a 45 inch with another song that was written for this album called You Make a Fool Out of Me, which Brendan Benson also re-recorded for one of his solo albums, My Old Familiar Friend. So two of Brendan Benson's songs didn't make it on this album.
And I will say this, I only know You Make a Fool Out of Me, but that has that sort of 70s sound again.
Yeah, it would have fit on the album, but I will say I think most of the songs here are stronger than it. I would have taken Open Your Eyes over five on the five for sure. So that's the only, I think, thing I would have done different. But if it was up to me, this album would not turn out sounding as good as it does, because this album is actually kind of self-produced. When you look at the production, you keep bringing up you love the production. It's mostly Jack White and Brendan Benson production. You don't
Which
have
is
any
wild.
other producer on here, just other engineers. Which most every album, even if it's self-produced, most albums have additional engineers, right? But there's no main producer on this album. It's just Jack White and Brendan Benson. Jack White even did a lot of the mixing, it looks like, and both him and Brendan Benson did the horn arrangements for Many Shades of Black and The Swish and the Spur.
Wow. Wow. Respect
Yeah.
to those guys. And, you know, and obviously we all know Jack White's a very talented guy, but you know, just hearing this, like, especially for an album that is like has a lot of memories for me and that I still find new appreciation for, like, that's just super cool to hear.
And speaking of Jack White, I mean, I think some of my favorite guitar moments from him are on this album, and tones, especially tones. I mean, I love the just like distorted tone on the opening track. I absolutely love the solo in the switch and the spur. The solo itself was very simple, but the tone just has like the right amount of like reverb. The wah on his guitar on Hold Up, I absolutely love. Really out there solo on Many Shades of Black. Like, that's the only thing on that song that makes it not a 60s throwback or 50s throwback, right?
Right.
It has a very modern Jack White solo that makes the
song
a hybrid.
You got the pitch shifter on it. Mm-hmm. Makes it sound trashy. Makes it sound like you threw it out in the rain, took it back in, beat it with a fish. Like, very cool stuff. And something that, you know, you kind of mentioned with, like, the whole McCartney-Lennon comparison is I kind of feel like this is genuinely a case where these two songwriters, artists, they bring out the best of each other. And there's some cool moments where you definitely see them in their own elements, but you also see them kind of step out of their element. For example, Salute Your Solution, one of your favorites, there's that part where I think Jack White sings the first verse of it, and then Benson sings the second verse of it, and, you know, it's more of a Jack White line, you know, it's a high-pitched yelling thing, and...
Yeah.
You know, I think, like, Jack White pulls it off, you know, a little bit better, but it's just cool to hear that contrast between their styles. And, you know, when a song gets as chaotic at 5 on the 5 with Jack White on it, you know, it's great. But then you follow it with Attention, another real heavy rock song, but you get Benson pulling a solid, you know, steady lead, and it
and
reigns
I don't know if
in
I,
the album.
I don't know if I call it, like, real heavy, because I think there's heavier songs on that. But yeah, like, Attention is definitely a more up-tempo, faster rock song than I think, you know, like, there are a couple songs in, like the Here in the Deadlights, I feel like that only ended up on his album because it was a Raconteurs song at some point, right? And, like, yeah, Attention, and they did that a lot, too, with the third album. There's a fast, like, punk rock song on the third album that Brendan Benson sings. And I want to say, like, Jack White wrote the music. And when they went to record it, Jack White was like, Brendan, why don't you write the lyrics for it and sing it? And he's like, are you sure? Because, like, this sounds like more, it's more up your alley. And Jack White's like, no, like, I think you'd sound great on it. And he does. It sounds cool. Like, yeah, Jack White would have done great on it, but it sounds almost cooler than Brendan Benson doing it. And yeah, I totally, that's why I love Attention, because it's got a Jack White sound, but with Brendan Benson doing the vocals. What I was going to say, because I kind of interrupted myself. Salute Your Solution. You're mentioning Salute Your Solution. Yeah, when I first heard that, I was like, wow, I was not expecting Brendan Benson. I mean, I guess at that point, I didn't know who Brendan Benson was. But when you listen to it now, you're like, yeah, that is not something Brendan Benson would normally sing. Even the lyrics, I wonder, because I unless I look in the liner notes on the actual vinyl copy, I don't know if it says who wrote the lyrics for each song or who wrote the music. But I swear Jack White had to write those lyrics, because he sings a line, I'm like a trash can holding on the information. But then Brendan Benson later, he sings a line that says, I found a ridicule that isn't cool for me at all. Which that has to be Jack White. Like, the kind of play on words. But it sounds great, Brendan Benson singing it. Don't get me wrong.
Right, right. Especially on that line where he's, like, a little bit flat with the vocal. It's, like, it's the perfect quirk. I think, like, to say, like, I think Rich Kid Blues is another good example where, because that starts with Benson, right? He does the quiet
verses.
Yeah,
he does the opening. Yeah, he does the verses, I guess. They both kind of sing when the music kicks in, and then Jack White does, like you said, like that part.
Yeah. And so, you know, in that song, you know, like, I feel like Benson's pushing himself to do a strong, high-pitched vocal, kind of like Jack White. Not an imitation, but I think they work well together. And, you know, I think it's cool that each member has their own, not each member, but each of them have their own songs where they just do all the vocals. Many Shades of Black being the big Benson one for me, and then Carolina Drama being the big Jack one. You know, no backup vocals from the other. So I don't know. That's just kind of cool to me that there's a complete solo song for each.
Yeah, and then the songs where they play together on, they sound like, You Don't Understand Me is, I think, more of a Jack White song, but, like, in the choruses, you definitely have Brennan Benson doing the vocals too. In fact, it might just be him and some backup maybe on the choruses on like the there's always another point of view, that line. That's probably one of my favorite, that's probably my favorite song on the album, You Don't Understand Me. Piano Ballad from
Wow.
Jack. I know it's like a, it's a safe choice, but
It's a really safe choice. There's a lot of interesting stuff
when
on
I
this
first heard
album.
that song, I don't know. I think it's just like a perfect written song. Like I think Jack White on the keys is cool because you don't always have a lot of Jack White songs with him playing piano or keyboard. I love the guitar tone that Brennan Benson has on his guitar. It's like he's playing these kind of like he's just playing like the woot chords, but his tone makes it sound a little jazzy. I don't know why. Like the rhythm, it fits so well with the drums and the bass. And then I love the bridge is one of my favorite moments of the song where they're doing the harmonies and they're like the what's the line where he's like, it's not that big of a deal. And one of them is doing like the high harmony, one's doing the lower harmony. Like, I love that section.
I was just kind of thinking about in this moment that the little transition where they do the
Yeah.
that feels like a very, very Ben Folds Five type of line transition.
And
And with the
maybe you're just, I
harmonies.
wonder if you're thinking of that too, because of like it's a piano song as well.
Yeah, maybe that adds to it.
And then the outro is great. Like Jack White does the most like Ben Folds thing he's probably ever done on the piano, where he's like just doing like a real, like, I mean, Brennan, sorry, not Brennan Benson. Ben Folds would be like way all over the piano doing like soloing like that. Jack White is just doing like a solo between like two different keys, I think.
Yeah, it just sounds like he's hitting the same key as fast as he can.
But it, I don't know where, like he's, yeah, it's like he's playing it raw. He's not playing it like safe, and that's how I feel like Ben Folds plays a lot of the time. Like
Right.
he'll slam his hand on the keyboard and he'll stand on it and stuff like that, you know.
There's a fearlessness to it, and I think it really does make the song triumphant at the end.
Yeah, and then you know, I do want to, we do definitely need to shout out, you know, Jack Lawrence. There's so many great bass moments on this album. And that's the thing is, it's not like the whole song is bass heavy, but like attention, the attention begins with that doo 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 the bass line, but then
With
later
this,
on, oh yeah, it's like what is it, like a fuzz patch or something?
yeah, it's like a fuzzy tone, but it's like real supple too. It's like it's a very cool sound.
And later on, that bass line ends up becoming like the guitar line that I'm pretty sure Jack White plays. The rhythms, the rhythm, not the rhythm, but the tempo change in Consolers of the Lonely, the song, the bass is very prominent. And like we mentioned, there's a section where it's just the bass, everything else drops out. I love, Switch on the Spur has some really cool bass moments too. That and Salute Your Solution, there's after that first riff, you know, the power chords, there's the
Yeah,
section where the
yeah,
drums
yeah.
are goes doo doo. Bam, bam, boo, doo, 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 doo.
Yeah.
And there's a lot of moments on the first album where I mean, like Steady As She Goes begins with that bass line, right? The simple doo doo doo. So he's really good. Jack Lawrence is great at finding moments to you know enter a bass line in the mix that's catchy and sticks in your head, but then he knows when to back away and let Jack or Brennan Benson take over the song.
Right. And I think something, a big part of why I like this album so much is it's because it's my type of album in the sense of it's chord progressions with some riffs thrown in, with a lot of overdubs, some orchestration, a lot of leads, harmonies. It has everything I like in a song. I think
Yeah.
that's a big part of why it's one of my favorite albums. I wouldn't go as far to say top 10. Then again, I haven't really made a rough list at all, but I would probably take a gamble and say top 50 for me.
Yeah, like I said, it's not, I feel like you have to like be a hardcore fan of Jack White or Brennan Benson to put in your top 10, but like I said, like I like the White Stripes, but I'm not familiar with their catalog as well as a lot of other people. In fact, I know way more Brennan Benson songs and albums than I would say White Stripe. You know, I like own all of them, but like I go out of my way to listen to the Raconteurs way more than I do the White Stripes.
And it's kind of crazy because I would rank it, I would say, pretty high. even though I say top 50, I feel like that's pretty high to rank an album when I only know like what, like one or two White Stripes album. I know a few Benson albums for sure. So I don't even know, you know, that much material from these guys, but I still think it's a great piece of work.
Yeah. I mean, it's this, to me, this album just has like everything I like in an album. And you know, even like the closing track, like I will say this album, I would say for me, it's more of a musical album than like a lyrical album. Like eventually I'm going to probably give you albums in my top 10 where I feel like the reason I love an album is because of the lyrics. So eventually if I give you Tom Petty's Wildflowers, it's not always because I love the music so much. A lot of it's because I love the lyrics so much, right?
Because you want to roll another joint.
But with this album, you know, like I said, there's some funny lines in like Solution and Switching the Spur has storytelling, but like Carolina Drama is like a great example of, you know, it's a song that shouldn't work as well as it is because it's like almost 6 minutes long. It kind of only really has like three parts. The verse, the like kind of in between bridge sections with like the little faint laws in the background. And then the big buildup at the end, right? And that's really it. And it just, it's a lot of the repeating verses that happen over and over. But he's telling the story of like this kid who finds his mom being beaten by this guy who is like her boyfriend. And he's like trying to fight the guy. And then like he finds he's not beating up his mom, he's beating up I'm making the story up. I'm confusing. I'm reading a Stephen
King. Two guys walk into a bar.
I'm reading a Stephen King book right now that actually has a lot of aspects to this the song, so I was confusing the two. The kid finds his mom's boyfriend beating up this other guy, right?
Yes, and, this priest.
A preacher or whatever. And then, like, he goes to stop the boyfriend from beating up on this guy. And he eventually hits the guy in the head with a glass bottle of milk. Because the song, like, takes place, like, in the 50s when people got, like, milk delivered to their houses, right? And like the mom rushes into the room or whatever and's like, that's your dad. And he's like, what? And like the guy that the preacher is the dad, like his real dad, right? And the story, you have to kind of connect your own dots. And I think to me, the story is that the actual father was the milkman delivering milk to them. And I think the boyfriend saw him around at their house and like maybe thought that the father was trying to get back with the mom. And that's why he started beating him up and like basically almost killing him, which I think he does kill him because at the end of the song, the protagonist in the song, the boy, he's like, let's bury the bodies underneath the tree and put daddy in the trunk and head to Tennessee. Right. But then the story ends with like, the kid's like younger brother coming in, and then the song ends with Jack White saying, if you want to know the true story, go ask the milkman. So the milkman's an important part of the story, which I believe is the father. It's very confusing. It's a story where there's really no like true, like you don't ever learn. It's a very vague story and you don't really learn what actually happens. But that's why I like it. It's like, it's very detailed in some sections and then in other sections, it's very vague. And you have to, like I said, connect your own dots and make up your own plot.
You know, I'm going to be honest. I don't know if the ending really makes that much sense when I try to put it together. I'm like, something feels a little bit misaligned, but I'm like, maybe I'm just too dense to get it.
Because there's a line too where the reason the father makes an appearance, like the reason that he's so important in the song is because the mom says he's been paying all the bills for years. Like,
yeah, the priest, right?
Yeah, which I think is the father, the real father, you know. But
the
I also think he's
the,
huh?
The priest isn't the milkman, though. Didn't you say the milkman's the father?
I think he might be both.
You think the milkman is the priest?
Yeah, I think he was delivering milk. And then the boyfriend saw him and recognized him and started beating him up. Okay. And then the son sees it and goes over. And because, like, why else would he kill him with a bottle? I don't know. Like, I feel like it's intentional that he kills him with a bottle of milk.
But here's what I don't get. Wouldn't he hit the boyfriend with the bottle? It kind of
that's what he
like,
does.
Right?
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay. So he doesn't kill the father then.
No, I think the father's the
you
father.
See what I'm saying? I feel like all these characters blur together with their actions.
There's only like three characters though. I don't know. I still like it just because every time I listen to it, I like make up a different perspective of the story in my head.
I still like it because I think Jack White does a fantastic job. Like, I don't even need to put the story together to like be like,
oh yeah, that buildup is insane. Like, there's a, like, when he sings the line, he says, he's singing the line through the eyes of the mom, and he says he's been paying all the bills for years. And when he sings that line, his voice kind of, like, what's the word? Kind of, like, wavers, yeah, because it's, like, because in the song, he says she collapsed in tears, he's been paying all the bills for years. So she's, like, crying. So when he delivers that line, it almost sounds like he's crying. And then right after it, he's singing through the perspective of the son, and the son yells, "Mama," and he like yells it really loud. And there's so much contrast in that vocal performance of that buildup and the climax of that song that, yeah, like you said, it's like brilliant. It's like, that's what sells the song. Even if you're like, if you think the story is convoluted and makes no sense or whatever, like the performance is what really does it.
I think for me, my favorite part of the vocal is when he says, you heard the boyfriend shout, "Get out." Just the way he shouts,
yeah.
"Get out." It just hits every
time.
Yeah,
that and when he yells, "Mama." Yeah, like those two lines, like the grit in his voice. Yeah, that's what I'm talking about. So, yeah, I think we can agree. There's no filler. I mean, I know you said pull this blanket off of me. Maybe it could be. But to me, a song that's under 2 minutes, if there's charming parts to it, I don't consider it filler.
Yeah, I mean, I don't want to say it is filler, but I think for me, like, my only actual critique with this album, it doesn't have to do with the lyrics. I think the lyrics, there's enough substance and cool lines that I don't see it as, you know, I think it does not limit the album. But I will say the end of the album, I think because of Pull This Blanket Off, it feels a little less maybe motivated. And I think for me, it's like, after you get attention, you get Pull This Blanket Off of Me, which is like right under 2 minutes. And it's like low key. And then you get Rich Kid Blues, which starts off low key as well, but gets really huge. And then you get These Stones Will Shout, which is acoustic. And it's you know, at the end, you get the Foo Fighters big bang out. And then you get Carolina Drama, which is 6 minutes of very storytelling, same progression, dynamic still, you know, to close it off. So those last four songs, roughly 15 minutes, don't have quite the same flow and gusto that, you know, the first, you know, 10 songs have. But that's overall, I think that's a small critique. I think an album should have some change in sound and flow as it progresses. And I think because it ends with such a banger, you know, for a closer, it's pretty passable for me. Forgivable.
Yeah, and I will say every time I hear this album, I always think Attention is later on the album. Like, I always think it's like the last three song, but it's kind of, I mean, it's the 10th song out of 14. So it is like on the second half, but I always think there's something in between Attention and Five on the Five. So I think maybe if you had like Attention after Rich Kids Blues, maybe the album would flow a little better for you.
Oh, are you suggesting? Wait. Attention after Rich Kid Blues?
Yeah.
Okay, so like what? Like Five on the Five? Well, you can't do Five on the Five and Pull This Blanket Off in a row, because that would feel
then Five on the Five, Rich Kids Blues, then Pull This Blanket Off of Me.
And then Attention.
Then Attention, then These Stones Will Shout.
Yeah. And yeah, I think that literally would fix the album
Yeah.
to be like, I mean, it's basically a 10 out of 10 in my eyes. I
Yeah,
mean,
to
how
me, this
perfect
is
can
a 10
something
out of
be?
this is a 10 out of 10. And like I said, I think anyone who likes rock music should listen to this album. Unless you just like can't stand Jack White. And I know there's some people who like think he's overrated. People who think Jack White's overrated are the guitarists who get pissy when he ends up on the top 50 of a guitar magazine's top 100 guitarist. And those
Right.
people are not adults. They need to grow up. But you know, I think if you like rock music, this, like you said, this is fantastically produced. It has a great kind of subgenres of music within the album, but for the most part, it sounds cohesive, and for the most part, it flows very nicely. I think the fact that you have two like singer-songwriters with Brandon Benson and Jack White writing these songs, that the songs, they have great dynamics, and they help each other's flaws. Where with the Brandon Benson song, if maybe it's a little too simple or straightforward or vanilla, Jack White makes it a little bit more zany. And then with the Jack White song, where sometimes it's lacking composition or it's lacking a solid foundation, Brandon Benson adds that to his songs, you know?
And then you have Little Jack and what is the other guy's name?
Patrick.
Peter? Patrick.
Patrick.
It starts with a P.
A solid rhythm set foundation right there. Oh, did you cut off? Or did I? Can I not hear? Hold on. Let's talk again.
Hello, hello.
I think it was me. I think I stepped on that cord.
Oh.
Sorry.
Yes, just saying they had the chops to pull off these big ideas.
Exactly. Oh, my internet connection is unstable. Ooh, okay.
Oh gosh, it feels like we're playing
Well,
Rocket League again.
but
And did
no,
you
but.
mention like the anniversary for this album?
No, but yeah, this album, when they decided that they were going to record a new album, they ended up through Jack White's record label, Third Man Records, through their vault, they released a what year would it, what anniversary was it? Was it for the pulling up the information right now. 2018. So for the 10-year anniversary, they released, which I actually have it. I guess I'll show it off. They released this version on vinyl, which the only difference on the cover that you can notice is that there is this copper color that has embellishments throughout the album cover.
It's kind of ugly.
But what's cool is the vinyl itself is like, it has that copper color to it. It's got like swirls and whatnot, which
Okay.
if you're a serious collector, you don't really care about that shit, but it still looks cool. And it came with a 45 of two brand new songs, which they like the next day, they're like, oh, these two songs are going to be off the new album that comes out in like a couple months.
That's
Well, it wasn't
sick.
a couple months. It was like the following year, but like they were like finishing a new album. So, not only was I able to get another version of this on vinyl of one of my favorite albums of all time, but it was like, oh, here's a new album and new tour, which was great for me because I got to see him on the tour twice, back-to-back shows. One of them I was front row because I won special tickets from the Third Man Records service. And yeah, and that was
And what,
fun.
now we're at the 15 year mark?
Yeah, and right now it's kind of, you know, Jack White's done a couple solo. He's done actually three solo albums. He's done at least two solo albums since this. Brandon Benson's done, I think, two since this album. And we're not sure right now. Jack White, he's going to be doing something soon because last year he didn't do anything because the year before he did two new albums. So it's going to be very interesting to see because people are thinking Dead Weather is due next for an album because they've had now like the longest, you know, years without a new album. But I don't know. Supposedly they wrote a lot of songs for that third record, Help a Stranger. So I could see them going back in the studio with those songs and finishing them for a new album. So, you know, they might not be fresh new songs, but they could be ideas that they had started during the last album. So And if they do something in the future, we're definitely we'll cover it on this podcast, whether we review the album or listen to it for the first time together, something like that. So, but yeah, go give this album a listen, and let us know what you think of this album. If this is an album you already love, let us know, and let us know if there's an album you want us to talk about in the future. You know, we like doing these album appreciation episodes for albums that we think maybe didn't get their justice when it comes to critical reviews or its placement on the charts or how many copies it sold. None of that stuff really matters, but it sucks when an album doesn't get, the mentions that it deserves. So stay tuned for that. And then next week we got a really fun episode, but I don't want to spill the beans on that one yet. So stay tuned for that. We hope you take care and you'll be hearing from us soon. Bye.
It's not that big of a deal.